acceleration is dv by dt. This is also equal to d square s by dt square. This we have learned in kinematics. So if acceleration is constant, the solution of this equation is what? V is equal to u plus at, v square equal to u square plus 2as, and s equal to ut plus half at square. This we have learned. This we can use only when acceleration is constant. Okay? And I also have alpha equal to what? D of omega by dt. Angular acceleration is rate of change of angular velocity. This is equal to d square theta by dt square. Right? It's not good out. So what are the solution of these equations if alpha is constant? Let me write down. If alpha is constant, tell me, instead of V, what is there?
Omega.
So omega is equal to initial angular velocity plus alpha into t. Okay? Then omega square equal to omega naught square plus 2 alpha delta theta, and your delta theta equals to omega naught t plus half alpha t square. Things are exactly same when you deal with it in algebraic way. It is exactly same. Ready? What if acceleration was not constant, then how we used to solve the problem? You remember? We used to use these equations directly. If acceleration was given as 2 times t, so here I write 2t is equal to dv by dt. Are you getting it? I won't use these three equations if t is not constant. Similarly here, if alpha is not constant, I will use this equation directly. Are you getting it? Alright, so let us take a couple of questions and see whether we can replicate whatever we have learned here onto this scenario. Fine? Any doubts? Okay, write down. A rigid body is spinning. Stop talking, focus here. Spinning with angular velocity 5 revolutions per second. Okay? Angular acceleration is minus of pi radians per second square. You need to tell me how many revolutions the object makes before coming to rest. How many revolutions it will make before coming to rest? Which formula will you use? Which one? Omega square equal to omega naught square plus 2 alpha delta theta, right? Why? Because final angular velocity is known to me. It is 0. And unnecessarily, I don't have to find t. Why will I find t and then substitute it later on? There is an equation which is independent of time. Okay? Which is what? Omega square this. Why I am using this? Because final angular velocity is how much? 0. Initial one is how much? How much? It is given 5 revolutions per second, but is it in its SI units? You need to convert it into the SI units. 5 revolutions per second, you have to convert in which units? Radians per second. 1 revolution is how many radians? 2 pi, so how many radians per second? 10 pi. 5 into 2 pi. Okay? So you must convert in SI units 10 pi radians per second. Omega naught is 10 pi, so 10 pi square into 2 into minus pi into delta theta. So delta theta comes out to be how much? What? 50 pi. Getting this? So how many revolutions? This divided by 2 pi. This is the total angle. Alright? 2 pi angle is 1 revolution. The number of revolution is 50 pi divided by 2 pi. 25 revolutions. Understood? Huh? Will it stop after 25 revolutions? What will happen after 25? It will start spinning in opposite direction there. Right now, angle loss is like this and deceleration is like that. So it will stop and then gain angle loss in this direction. Getting it? Okay. One more question. Please write down. Angular acceleration is given as 5 minus t radians per second square. 5 minus t radians per second square. It starts from rest. Initial angular loss is 0. You need to find out time when the angular loss becomes 0 again. Find out the time when angular loss becomes 0 again. Is angular acceleration constant? So I can't use those formulas. Angular acceleration is not constant. So I can't use the direct formula. What I have to do? I have to write 5 minus t as d omega by dt. Okay? So d omega will be 5 into dt minus t dt. Integrate this. Limits will be from 0 to 0. Initial velocity is 0 and final is also 0. Okay? This will be from 0 to t. This will be again from 0 to t. So what do you get? 5t minus t square by 2 is equal to 0. So t is equal to 10 seconds. Getting it? When you equate 5 minus t equal to 0, you are getting a time when angular acceleration becomes 0. Okay, just because alpha has become 0 doesn't mean omega is 0. It's like saying that if acceleration is 0, velocity is also 0. It need not be. See, what happens is when t is very small, alpha is positive. It will accelerate. After t becomes large, alpha becomes negative. So then it decelerates. Ready? Initially alpha was positive. It started at some angular velocity. After some time, alpha become negative. So it is trying to stop it now. Okay? Fine. So like this, there are several questions and you will see that the method of solving this question, these kind of questions are exactly same the way we have done motion in 1D or motion in 2D. We have done a lot of problems. Okay, the concept, the underlying concept that you should equate d omega by dt is exactly same as the way we used to do it earlier. Yes or no? Right? So just have to do a couple of problem practice and everything will be similar. Okay? Fine. So coming back to the kinematics of rigid body, how do you think the rigid body can move, the motion of rigid body. Can rigid body move like this? It can move. What kind of motion this is? This is only translational. We have discussed it. Okay? It can just stop at one location and rotate. What is this? Only rotational. And while rotating also it can move forward. This is translation plus rotation combined. Okay? And the way translation and rotation are combined can also be in a different way. Have you seen that when the wheel is moving forward, what is happening to the axis? Is axis remaining fixed? What is happening to it? The axis also moving forward with the wheel. If this is the wheel, this is the axis, like that. When wheel moves forward, is axis moving forward? Right? So axis can move forward, alright? And have you seen the top plane? How does it rotate? It rotates like this as well as like that, yes or no? So its axis, what it is doing? Axis is also rotating. Okay, hold on, hold on. Dhyan, Shreyas. Stand up. On your desk. Khada despair. So I used to get punishment like this when I was. You have not got such kind of punishment ever. So do I, we? Hello, brother. Better. You're dreaming? Kya sapna aa raha tha, bata? Huh? तो सो जो रहा है कल रात को सोया ठीक से इफ इट्स नॉट प्रॉपर्ली हां नो इसकी नींद उड़ गई क्या हो गया व्हाट हैपेंड व्हेन द सेंटी हो गया ठीक है चल टेक केयर अरे तो व्हाट एवर सेइंग वाज Okay. Yeah, focus. So you have played by top, right? When? You played the top. You have seen top. So I say you wrap the KVPY. So the axis of the top is also rotating like this, yes or no? Right? And when you put a keychain on your finger and rotate like this, your finger is the axis of rotation, that is also rotating. Right? So translation plus rotation can happen in different ways. In our syllabus, only one kind of translation plus rotation is there, when axis translates. Axis should not rotate. Are you getting what I'm saying? Okay? So, like for example, the wheel when it is moving forward, the axis, what it is doing? It is following a straight line path or not? Axis is only translating when the wheel is rotating and moving forward. So this kind of motion is there in our syllabus, but not when axis also rotates. Fine? So, we can summarize. Stop talking. This is pure translation. All the point. What is the pure translation? All the points are moving with the same velocity, same acceleration. So if you draw a straight line like this, or any straight line you draw like this, will it change its orientation? will remain like that only. It will move parallel to itself. Any line you draw on the rigid body, if rigid body is doing pure translation, that line will go straight. Why? Because all the points have the same velocity, same acceleration. Okay? Write down pure spinning. When does pure spinning happens? When axis is fixed. Axis is fixed. Rigid body is not going anywhere. Okay? So the axis is fixed. And we have just learned that if axis is fixed, all the points are moving in a circle with center where? On the axis. Okay, this is what we have studied just now. Got it? Okay. And there can be a case which is spinning plus translation. The object rotates like this as well as moves forward. Got it? It can rotate and move forward. Like for example this, it rotates and moves up and down. Okay? This is more generic motion. Rigid body typically does this. What happened? How can we analyze this motion? Anyone? I mean, it becomes very complicated, right? When suppose this pen is moving in air, the top of this is not going in a circle. It is just doing some weird motion. For example, this is the pen. When it is rotating, you can see this top of the pen is probably following this path. It is not a circular motion. Okay? So how can we analyze the motion in this case? Like how? Why? Not convincing, but yeah. Anyone? Anyways, how can I visualize the motion? He's saying separate the spinning and translation, which is correct in a way, but how can I separate it? I mean, the process of separating, how will you separate it? I'm not asking how can you do it. I'm asking how will you separate it? The process of it. Huh? Is there a fixed axis over here? There is no fixed axis. It is moving forward. If axis is fixed, the object won't go anywhere. Like for example, fan. Fan has a fixed axis. Okay? What do you mean by that? Okay, so please write down. In rotation plus translation motion, in rotation plus translation motion, we observe the motion of all the points. We observe the motion of all the points relative to the center of mass. Then we observe the motion of all the points relative to the center of mass and then add the center of mass motion on it. You first observe the relative velocity with respect to center of mass, how it is moving, and then when you add the center of mass's velocity on it, you get total velocity, yes or no? If if suppose I am going forward, let's say I am going forward with 5 meter per second, then with what velocity this object will appear to me, this one? Minus 3 backwards, right? How it comes? You have subtracted your velocity from whatever you are looking at, right? So observer sees the world by subtracting his or her own velocity, and that is what the relative velocity is. What is the relative velocity? Velocity of object minus velocity of observer. And who is the observer right now in a rigid body? Center of mass. Center of mass is the observer. So you observe relative to center of mass. So you got the velocity of the point minus velocity center of mass. So when you add the velocity center of mass, you get the total velocity. Understood? Okay. Now why we are doing all this? Why I am observing the motion of other points relative to center of mass? What is the reason for it? Relative motion is lot simpler. What kind of relative motion is? What kind of relative motion? With respect to center, how the points are moving? Circle. With respect to center of mass, everything is moving in a circle because the distance is fixed between any two points. Yes, sir. Not necessary. You take any point with respect to that point, it will be circular motion. Because distance is fixed. Okay? Now, the reason why keep on talking? Can I observe with respect to any point on the rigid body and still I will get circular motion only relative to that point? All the points motion? Yes, I will get the circular motion only. But why center of mass? Why I am looking everything with respect to center of mass and not with respect to any other point? First is, we already know the location center of mass, how to find the formula and all. Okay, easy to locate. Second or more important thing, you will understand later on where you learn about the torque and other things. If you don't take the center of mass, if you don't observe with respect to center of mass, the pseudo forces act from the center of mass and it will have some torque. Okay, we'll learn about all this later on. Okay, to nullify the torque because of the pseudo forces, we usually observe with respect to center of mass and then add center of mass's motion on it. Okay, and whenever you are confused what to do in this chapter, always follow the center of mass. Okay, that is a thumb rule. Okay. At times the explanation why the center of mass is not so straightforward, but you can use it like a thumb rule that observe with respect to center of mass what is happening and then add what center of mass is doing. Got it? There will be force, pseudo force will be there, but torque due to pseudo force will be zero. That is why pseudo force is zero. Pseudo force, torque will be, distance from the center of mass will be zero. Because it is acting from the center of mass.